Hi, I'm Tamara, and today I am going to walk you through all of the 10 steps that you need to know before you start making your patchwork quilted jacket. They're super cute and super comfy. All right, so before I jump into all of the 10 steps that you need to know, I do want to let you know that I will link to a blog post down in the description down below, and that blog post will explain all of these steps in a little bit more detail, and I will have links to a whole bunch of different patterns that will work best to make a patchwork quilted jacket. All right, so the first thing that you need to know is what type of jacket you want to make. Are you going to make a jacket that has lining, or would you rather make a jacket without lining? Are you making a jacket from a quilt that you found at a thrift store? If so, then of course the quilt has already been put together. So then the best method for you will be to make a quilted jacket without a lining. If you are cutting a quilt that you found maybe at a thrift store or a quilt that was gifted to you, just double check that that quilt is not an antique quilt, because you do not want to be cutting up the wrong quilt. If you're making your panels specifically for your quilted jacket, then you have a little bit more flexibility. You could do a jacket with a lining, which is what I did with this jacket here, or you could do without lining as well. You'll just need to make your quilted panels pre-quilted, so all three layers instead of two layers. All right, so once you've decided what way you're gonna make your coat, then it's time to look at what type of patterns you want to choose. There is a coat that's really popular on Instagram right now made by a particular gal. I believe her name is Brittany, and her Instagram page is connected, of course, with her Etsy page. So she makes gorgeous jackets and she sells them on Etsy. I'll definitely link to her in the description down below. And her coats are popular because they have a beautiful ombre look to them. They're fairly fitted in the sleeve, and they have a hood. And so when you're looking for a pattern, think, do you want a hood? Don't you want a hood? Do you want to do your patchwork in an ombre pattern or not? Are you using a quilt that's already been made and you're just gonna cut it up for this pattern? All of these things you kinda wanna think through before you're choosing your pattern. I would suggest when you're looking for a pattern for a quilted jacket that you actually look for a pattern where the sleeve attaches right here by your shoulder. I ended up going to Paper Cut Pattern Pieces, I believe. I'll link to all of these in the description down below. So that particular jacket is the jacket that I ended up making for myself. So you can definitely check that pattern out, especially if you're looking for something with lining. If you are looking for a jacket without lining, there's a really popular jacket called the Tamarack jacket, I believe. And that particular pattern is a bit shorter of a jacket, but it walks you through all of the steps that you need to add that binding to the jacket. So you're not doing a ton of guesswork. There's an array of patterns that you can choose from. Just check out those links and you will start to get a feel for what you're looking for. Step three is what to avoid when you're looking for patterns for that quilted jacket. So things that you want to avoid are a lot of extra details to the jacket, because when you're making a quilted jacket, the quilt is going to shine and all those extra details are actually going to end up unseen. So you don't need a fancy jacket to make a quilted jacket. Second, if the pattern that you're looking at has a jacket that actually has a lot of like flowing edges, sometimes the arms are very flowy, remember quilts are stiff, so they're not going to fall nicely. So that pattern probably would not be a good choice. My fourth tip is consider doing a test run on your pattern. So with the pattern that I chose, I'm really excited with how it turned out. However, I had to make some adjustments at the end because what I realized was the pattern I chose fits large. So had I done a pre-run, what I would have realized is I really liked the arms, they fit my arms really well, but the body of the jacket, I would have taken in about two sizes. Step five is buying fabric. Now, there are a few things to consider when you're buying fabric, especially if you're doing the patchwork style like I did on my jacket here. No matter what type of quilt panel you're making for your jacket, you are going to need so much more fabric than the pattern will ask for, because as you sew all of your patchwork squares together, of course it's all going to shrink away because of all of your seams. So definitely make sure that you overbuy on your fabric. Consider the fact that you will obviously need to buy batting, which your pattern will probably not ask you to buy, and you will need to buy backing or lining fabric. So for myself, because I wanted to do that ombre patchwork look, I ended up buying 16 different types of fabric. I bought about a quarter of a meter, a quarter of a yard of each. You can do as many fabrics as you like. I know that the gal who inspired me to do this jacket, she does about 30 different fabrics when she makes her jacket. So you can get as crazy as you want, but if this is your first patchwork quilted jacket, I would suggest less is more. The next thing to consider is, are you going to do your entire jacket in that patchwork look, or are you going to do a few of the pieces with just plain quilted fabric? For myself, I made sure that my hood and the arms were more of a plain fabric that matched some of the patches within the jacket. So I bought 2 extra meters for the arms and the hood. That way I did not have to patchwork that. It went a little faster that way as well. Another thing patterns will look for is fusible or stabilizers or interfacing, something to make particular areas of the jacket a little bit more stiff. I would suggest not doing those because your quilt itself is going to create that stiffness. So I skipped that step in my pattern and I had no issues. You are going to want to pre-wash all of your fabric, but do not pre-wash your batting. Now moving on to step 6, we are going to be making our panels for our jacket. To do this, we'll need to be cutting out our patchwork squares. When you're cutting out your patchwork squares, I would suggest cutting out 4-inch by 4-inch squares. That's what I ended up doing for my jacket here. I did do 5-inch by 5-inch squares for this toddler jacket that I'm making here. But to be honest, I just find the 4-inch by 4-inch squares give such a nicer look to the jacket, and it allows that patchwork look to shine. Now, you can make your panels with the backing or without the backing. You'll sew all of your squares together at 1/4 inch. Another thing when you're making your panels is to consider where your panel pieces are going to be lining up. You do want to try to allow these lines to line up. So definitely make your panels about the same size for the front of your jacket and the back of your jacket. Remember that when your pattern pieces are cut out, you are often cutting out mirrored images of each other. So don't make your panels to fit particular pieces and think that you can just lay your pieces all out onto one single panel, because often it's a lot easier to fold the panel in half and mirror image some of those pieces. So when you're creating your panels, just keep that mirrored image in mind. When you are doing a pocket that's going to lay on top of the jacket, so not one that's actually inset into the jacket, I'm going to suggest that you make your panels a little bit differently. What you'll do is you'll actually cut out your batting the size that the pattern calls for, and then I just trimmed away about 1/2 inch of excess away from that batting just using my quilting ruler, and I did it around the entire edge. That way I have now essentially created a template for my finished pocket. Then what I did was I laid a larger piece of backing fabric and a larger piece of my panel, so I sandwiched that batting, and then I actually quilted and basted that pocket. So step 7, you are now ready to baste and quilt your panel pieces. Once you've sewn all of your squares together and you've sewn all of your strips of your squares together, then you can lay it on top of your batting and you can attach it to your batting. If you are doing the no lining coat, then you'll also want to add the backing as well. So you'll sandwich that batting between the backing and your quilted top to make your panel pieces. Now there are a few things that you want to remember before you start basting and quilting. Once you start sewing the panel pieces onto your batting and your backing, if you're adding that backing, your fabric is going to shift a little bit as you start sewing all of these pieces together. Make sure that your batting is cut about 1 to 2 inches wider along your entire panel piece, as well as your backing. Next, Next, you're going to choose how you want to baste your actual panel pieces together. You can use a spray baste, which is pretty easy to use, especially when you're working with such small panel pieces, or you can use pins. If you are going to use pins, make sure you are pinning all of those layers together with a lot of pins. If you are doing some of your pattern pieces just with a big chunk of fabric, like what I did with the arms and with the hood, then you'll need to use a water-soluble marker or pencil and draw. Now double check that of course it washes off of your fabric before you use it, but then draw the lines ahead of time before you sew your patchwork onto those solid fabric pieces. Another thing to consider is extending your stitch length, and that stitch length looks so much nicer when it's just that little bit longer than your natural stitch. So this jacket here, if you look closely, I did not extend those stitches, but then on this jacket here, I extended the stitch length and it just gives it a nicer look in the end. And finally, as far as putting all of your panel pieces together, do consider those smaller pieces. So for me, my pockets, I actually put that aside and did that later because I wasn't sure exactly where my panels were going to line up, and I wanted to make sure that my pockets lined up with the particular patches on the jacket itself. So step 8 is finally cutting into your panel pieces or your quilt. So for myself, what I did was I lined up my pattern pieces onto my panel, and I lined up the bottom of the pattern pieces with the bottom of the panel. That way my ombre look moving up and my seams moving up would all match going around the entire jacket, because then when I moved to my second panel to cut the back of my jacket, I knew that all I had to do was line up my pattern piece along with the bottom of that panel and cut out that as well, and it would actually match to the front. Another thing that I did for cutting out my panels is my back piece. I chose to lay it on the one side straight down one of the center seams of my panel. That way everything was nice and straight. I cut out that one half, I folded it over, and then I cut out the mirrored image. Another thing to do with the arms, so that you can have that matching symmetry, whether you've done patchwork or you've just quilted out a bunch of the same fabric, you can line up the arms. So cut out the one arm and then lay that arm mirrored image on top of your other panel, and then you can line up those top stitches so that they match up before you actually cut out your pattern piece. That way you've created the symmetry that you want for those arms and for the hood as well. To cut out our pockets, it's a little bit different than what we've cut everything else out as, because we cut that batting just that little bit smaller. What you'll end up doing is taking your ruler again and you'll cut out about an extra inch around the batting. So what I do is I feel for where the batting is in between those sandwiched pieces, and then I use my quilter's ruler and I trim away all of the excess except for 1 inch. Along the top of my pocket, I actually give myself about 1.5 inches of fabric. And then what you end up doing is you fold it inwards towards the edge of that batting, and then you'll fold it in again. So you'll create a finished look without having that excess batting in the way, creating bulk. And now it's time for step 9. We are going to start sewing our pattern together. To do this, you may end up needing a stronger needle. If you do, just look for a needle like a jean needle. Another thing to note, you may need to trim away excess bulk. So I did that in a few different areas of my jacket. That way I was able to turn it right side out and see crisp points. So for my jacket, you'll see I have these top edges here. So what I would suggest you do is just trim away a little bit of that bulk right by that corner before you turn it right side out. That way your excess batting doesn't create a bulky, ugly look, but instead you can still do your pointed corners quite nicely. Of course, you want to make sure if you are trimming away that bulk that you're not getting too close to that seam and ruining the structure of the jacket. Another thing that the pattern will call for often is pressing your seams open. And And I did not press my seams open for this jacket. However, if you are doing the binding version to a jacket, then pressing those seams open will help because it'll separate them apart enough that you'll be able to add your binding on. Now, talking about adding binding, if you're not doing a jacket with lining and you do want to add binding, then what you're going to do is you're going to take your jacket, pretend you're not seeing batting, but you're actually seeing a backing piece of fabric. So you'll take your binding and you will lay it along these ugly edges here. So here we've got an ugly edge in our jacket. You'll take your binding, you'll open it up and you'll lay the one edge along here. Sew a seam just along that inner folded edge. And then you'll be able to fold your binding over and then over again. And then you'll sew along that edge and you will have hidden those ugly seams within your jacket. You'll use this binding as well to go along your neckline as well as your armholes. So when you're doing a jacket without lining, then that's where you'll end up adding your binding. Another thing to consider, depending on the jacket pattern that you've chosen, is adding extra top stitch seams where maybe the pattern isn't calling for it. So for myself, I did a top stitch around this top edge, and it just created that crisp, firm edging that I was looking for. And of course, sewing all of your pattern pieces together, you will be following the pattern that you've chosen. However, remember that you probably don't need to be using any other extra little details that your pattern is calling for that you think that with a quilted jacket, it may not be necessary. For my pattern, it called for a casing so that I could cinch up the waist. That would have been nice if I would have used a bit more of a flexible fabric. However, I knew that my quilt fabric just wasn't going to cinch up nicely, so I omitted that step from my pattern. And now you are at step 10, where you get to enjoy your beautiful quilted jacket. I hope that you enjoyed this tutorial. If you did, please click that thumbs up button. Please leave me any comments down below if you have any questions or you have other patterns that I have not listed that you think make awesome quilted coats. Please subscribe, hit that notification bell so that you don't miss future tutorials. And as always, I hope you have a wonderful day. I'll see you next time. Bye!